Welcome to Eureka. In this show, we are going to have a very wonderful, very insightful conversation with Dr. G. Raju. He was a former project director of Isro. He was part of the project in developing a satellite called Megatropics, an Indo-French collaboration. We are going to talk about him, his work, how Isro developed from the days when it was transporting rockets in cycles and bullock carts to what it is today. Before that, let's take a quick look at his brief profile. Keep watching Eureka. After this profile, we are going to continue this very wonderful conversation, which is going to be very interesting, very exciting. Keep watching Eureka.
India's space agency, ISRO, provides many societal services since its inception. Out of these, the most notable are navigation systems and space weather. It is where Dr. Raju Garudachar did extensive work. Presently, Dr. G. Raju is the professor in School of Engineering and Technology and Aerospace in International Institute of Aerospace Engineering and Management at Jain University. In this university, Dr. G. Raju is currently guiding 10 PhD scholars addressing climate change, navigation and disaster monitoring, out of which few are ISRO funded. He did his BE in Electronics from Bangalore University and ME in Electronics from BITS Pilani. After that, obtained PhD degree in the year 1989 in Radar Remote Sensing. Dr. G. Raju did the outstanding work in ISRO Ahmedabad when he was a microwave scientist in 1972, worked on microwave hardware and subsystems for spaceborne microwave remote sensing missions. He was a lead member in developing the first Indian remote sensing payloads on Bhaskar 1 and 2 satellites. He also developed and successfully operated an airborne and truck-operated coherent Antarctic radar depth sounder, unfocused synthetic aperture radar for ice probing in Antarctica. Dr. G. Raju received various national and international recognition. Noted among them are ISRO Team Excellence Award 2011 for Mega Trophy Satellite Project, also as Team Leader, and US NSF Antarctica Service Medal for Service in Antarctica, among others.
Thank you for being with us in the show. I mean, it's a very wonderful opportunity. So from Raj Sabha Television and our viewers, we thank you for being with us, spending your time.
Yes.
So let me start with this curious question that I have. I want to ask this question to many people in ISRO, so I'm going to ask you.
Yeah.
In those days, I mean, you would have joined ISRO 40 plus years ago, you know, somewhere around 1970s.
Yes.
Well, I was just born and maybe about 7 years that time. That time, space was not such a glamorous stuff, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you have become an engineer, you could have become a... somebody top in the government, right? How did you choose ISRO? Why did you go to ISRO?
Yeah, I started my career in 1972, immediately after my M.Tech from BITS Pilani. So the first job, the first interview I faced was in ISRO.
Mm-hmm.
At that time in 1972, it was still under a Department of Atomic Energy.
Okay.
There was a transition, there was some kind of a concern whether we are going to, the name was not given as ISRO or Space Application Center at that time. We were still under the Department of Atomic Energy. So what attracted me was, when I attended the first interview in 1972, was the way we were welcomed. It was a very informal reception. I remember that my first leader head was Mr. O.P.N. Kalla.
Okay.
He was a very, very adventurous, I should say, very high initiative used to take. He made us very comfortable that nothing is impossible. If I say this, no, everything is doable. That confidence is, that seed was sown by him, supported by another very senior colleague, Mr. N.S. Pillai and Dr. Shankara.
Okay.
These are the three names I will never forget.
Mm-hmm.
They started, I started my career under such people's monitoring, I should say. There was a continuous encouragement to look at new things. The first, very first project which I attempted was to look at the sun,
mm-hmm.
radio telescope, trying to do something to receive signal from the sun.
Mm-hmm.
We never knew what it was, what kind of signal it is. There were not many books. There were some few books, not much of publications. So the information we learned by doing mistakes.
Okay.
We learned by mistakes.
Uh-huh.
Finally, we were able to do a radiometer,
mm-hmm.
and in a project mode.
Mm-hmm.
What I was looking, the instrument which was looking at the sun, it is nothing but a radiometer. It's a sensitive.
So what is this radiometer? I mean,
yes.
By the name, I understand something like. The sun perhaps emits radio waves.
Yes,
you are measuring its intensity or what? I mean, what exactly are you doing?
The two parts here. The astronomer will look at the sun as a source of energy. He will look at the activities, that is radio telescope, that was being done in PR, physical research laboratory.
Okay.
There was a very big group of radio astronomy in PRL, and we started doing something in that connection.
Okay.
But suddenly we thought, why not look at the Earth rather looking at the Sun, because the remote sensing was coming into picture those days.
Uh-huh. No, what is this radiometer?
The radiometer is basically, it's a receiver, sensitive receiver,
uh-huh.
which receives the signals emitted by various objects.
Okay, something sun, like a radio
simple
in your house. Right.
Yeah, it's a simple receiver, yes. It's similar
so to why you want to call it as a radiometer? I mean, after you can call it as a radio,
it's
all,
a measures radio waves.
Uh-huh.
So, what is the first principle involved, the physics behind the radiometer is, all of us, all the objects, we are radiating.
Yeah.
You are radiating, I am radiating, all the objects are radiating. So, we are all black body radiators.
Hmm.
But we are not black body, we call grey body.
Yeah.
So, depending upon your physical temperature, and your emission coefficient, that is the emissivity, I can characterize various objects.
Mm-hmm.
For example, sea, water, land,
okay.
human beings. Then it's also various remote sensing targets like vegetation.
Uh-huh.
All those things can be detected
uh-huh.
by what is known as signature study.
Okay, okay. So let me understand this clearly.
Yeah.
What you are trying to say is, I may not be knowing, and most of my viewers might be surprised, that we are all transmitting radio waves.
Yes.
That's what you are saying.
Exactly.
So it's not only the All India radio station radio station which is transmitting radio waves, but you and me and all the viewers, perhaps maybe your chair, my chair,
everything is radiating.
And then everything is radiating in a particular way.
It is. See,
it's like our thumbprint.
Yes.
So my radio waves, and perhaps because you are also human,
that
may be much closer.
Precisely.
And it will be very different from, let's say, a paddy field.
Yes.
Even though all of us are living.
That's right.
This is what you are saying.
Exactly.
Interesting.
To compare a black body, take an example of a black body at 300 degree Kelvin.
Okay.
Now, the principle behind this is Planck's law.
Uh-huh.
According to Planck's law, if you reduce it to simple terms,
mm-hmm.
I am emitting 300 multiplied by 1. 1 uh-huh. is the emissivity of black body.
Okay.
So, I am giving you energy or radiation is coming from me. By a factor, by a number, which is called brightness temperature. I am bright to that extent. It's called brightness temperature. The problem is, these are very, very, very picowatts of power.
Okay, okay. Very, very minute.
Very, very minute.
Okay.
So,
okay.
Differentiation.
So, something like, for example, micro bodies, I mean, you need a microscope to see it.
Yeah,
that's why you cannot use the ordinary radios to do this, right?
Exactly. See, mm-hmm. in a radio, we have an amplifier.
Okay.
Whereas, when I want to detect your radiation, I must have a very, very sensitive receiver.
Okay.
The receiver can be built at different frequencies.
Okay. Uh-huh,
uh-huh. Let us take any frequency, any particular frequency, radio wave, let us say kilohertz or megahertz or gigahertz. Let us talk gigahertz.
Mm-hmm.
In that frequency, I build a receiver.
Okay.
The received energy is proportional to your physical temperature and the emissivity.
Okay.
That I have already just now told. Assume that we have got two, three different objects, all of them are same 300 degree Kelvin,
mm-hmm.
but their property of emission is different.
Will be different.
Different. So that's why I can differentiate between a water body, or a vegetation, or a rock, or a soil.
Now I see something. If every object is going to emit radio waves and yes. in a particular signature characteristic,
yes. yes.
you are saying that if I put this receiver on a satellite,
yes.
I can actually know where on earth, for example, paddy is being grown,
yes.
where on earth there is forest cover,
yes.
where on earth there is barren land, right?
Exactly.
So this is what you call as remote sensing.
Remote sensing, that's right.
Yeah, yeah. Can you say a few words on this?
Yes, remote sensing, let us say that broadly we have active and passive.
Okay.
What is passive? It's like a camera.
Yeah.
What does the camera do? It just receives the reflected radiation. So camera will receive the reflected sun radiation.
So sun is shining on the object and then it is reflecting?
Yes.
So that will be a passive instrument?
Yes. I am picking up the reflected.
Okay.
Suppose there is no sun. I cannot do it.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I use a flash.
Uh-huh.
When I use a flash with a camera, it becomes a radar.
Oh, okay. So you send a radar signals to ground.
Yes.
And then look at that reflection. So you will have a much better understanding of the characteristics.
Yes.
This is very interesting, and this is where we will take a very short break. It's going really very interesting. Sorry, maybe we have to take a short break.
Sure.
Keep watching Eureka. It's a very exciting stuff. We will take a very, very short break. After the break, we will continue this conversation. Keep watching Eureka. Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very wonderful, very insightful, very educative conversation with Dr. G. Raju. He was a former project director in Isro. Before the break, we were talking about the principles of remote sensing. There are two, you said, passive and active. Passive, you use the sunlight and its reflection.
Yes.
In active, you send a radar or maybe microwaves or other kinds of electromagnetic waves. Look at its reflection and see.
Yes.
Okay. Now let's come to your work.
Yes.
You constructed this very sensitive radiometer.
Yeah, radiometer for Bhaskara 1 satellite.
That's where I want to start talking about. How did you get into this Bhaskara 1 satellite? When was it? Just give us some background about it.
Yes. See, we wanted to find some application on meteorology and oceanography.
Okay.
One of the very important topics in weather prediction.
Okay.
So we were given to understand that there is a proposal to launch a remote sensing satellite, and the ISRO was looking for some suitable payloads.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So we were wanting to do our payload, try it on that.
Mm-hmm.
Our competitor was a TV payload, two mm-hmm. different competitor, co-passenger was mm-hmm. TV payload, takes the picture from the space. So that is how we started. We built the radiometer at a very high frequency, which is sensitive for atmospheric water vapor.
Okay.
Liquid water, ocean surface, mm-hmm. winds. These are the major components.
Was it a passive instrument or
it's
active?
It's a passive instrument.
Uh-huh.
Why passive instrument? This is a simple instrument.
Uh-huh.
When you have a radar, you need a powerful transmitter.
Yeah.
So we don't have, at that time, we didn't have big power sources, power supply, where I need about 100 kilowatt, kilowatts of power to run a radar.
Uh-huh.
Where we were told, this is the available payload power for you, this is the space, this is the mass.
Mm-hmm.
So within that constraint, we designed three radiometers.
Okay.
Three radiometers were used for we were all learning phase.
Uh-huh.
We were not sure what it will do, but we got wonderful pictures.
Okay.
The very first picture was
this was put in the Bhaskara 1.
Bhaskara 1 radiometer.
So this is which year?
This is 1979.
1979.
No,
Forty years back.
We had a very little knowledge what it can do.
And that is the first satellite India built on its own.
It is Aryabhatta was the first satellite, but remote sensing. Yes,
is the first satellite.
First remote sensing satellite was Bhaskara 1, followed by Bhaskara 2.
Let me just question you on this. As a scientist, perhaps were fascinated by what you are doing.
Yes.
scientists are like that.
Yes.
Okay, and then it's very, very passionate to you. You build a radiometer, and then you are looking at its option, weather. But on the other hand, if you look at it, that you are looking at this radiometer to do something related to meteorology. weather prediction.
Yes.
Was it merely, let's say, a scientific passion, or did you also see some social applications?
Yes, applications. Mm. We could see the cyclone formation.
Oh.
We were excited to see the cyclonic formation with the minimum kind of design.
Oh.
We could see the Bay of Bengal.
Mm.
We could see the formation of cyclone by looking at different times of the September, October, August, September, October time. We could see the cyclone. And that was a very, very exciting moment. Yes. Our instrument has done the job it was meant for.
Okay.
And we also looked at the wind, surface wind speed,
mm.
for which we went on a ship and measured this is the wind speed actually, and compares well with the data that I am getting from the satellite.
Let me understand. Mm. So what you are saying is that you put this instrument on a spacecraft.
Yes.
You measured the wind speed.
Yes.
But you wanted to make sure that that is actually the wind speed.
Yes.
So we went on a ship.
Yes.
Checked. So it's something called, yes, ground truthing, right?
It's called sea truth. Those days we were calling sea truth. We did in one of the later stages of the Bhaskara mission.
Okay. So then you'll have much more confidence.
Much more confidence.
Results that are coming,
yes,
from.
As you said, ground truth is for the things like, for suppose you have a vegetation.
Uh-huh.
What kind of scattering or emission it is giving.
Mm.
I want to make sure assign that value of emission property to that particular object.
So tomorrow if you see the same thing elsewhere,
precisely,
you will know that, yeah, it's the,
yeah,
same one.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, for example, today I am hearing your voice, I know that it's you. Tomorrow I am in some place and then I hear that voice somewhere in behind or some room. Then, yeah, I think, oh, it's looking like Dr. Raju's voice.
Yeah.
Right? So that's how. Yeah, very, very, very interesting.
So
it's not only that you send a spacecraft, but you also follow it up to,
yes,
ensure that the,
yes,
information,
yes,
is correct,
yes,
right?
Yes.
That's how,
yes,
the science works.
Yes.
Confidence
and
building.
Yes. And also we had interacted with some 70 to 80 user agencies.
Okay.
We called them for a workshop.
Mm.
You have this instrument, can you use it? You tell us. We have given you a sample, what it can do. They developed, everybody was new to this.
Mm.
So everybody took a lot of interest. They learned from the very beginning. That's how the science of applications developed. So the limited application was there for meteorology and oceanography because the area was large, resolution, but not for detecting anything on the land.
Okay. Okay.
For which you need a radar.
Oh.
So our initial expectation or the objective was only for oceanography and meteorology.
So any long journey starts with small steps, right?
Yes, yes.
So that's,
yes,
how the small step,
sure,
you started,
yeah,
with,
yeah,
Bhaskara,
yeah, yeah,
1.
Yeah.
And also continued with Bhaskara 2.
Bhaskara 2, yes.
Okay.
We had an additional frequency. For example, we had 3 frequencies in the second one.
Mm.
In the first one, only 2 frequencies. So we added one more component of liquid water content in the atmosphere.
Okay.
This is how we developed from Bhaskara 1 to Bhaskara 2.
Okay.
Of course, later on, there was some gap. We launched the OceanSat 1 and OceanSat 2 based on microwave technology.
Mm.
We had similar radiometers.
Mm-hmm.
Radiometers, because we didn't have enough power. It,
okay,
continued for some time. We did not want to venture in the higher power category. Yes.
Okay, so you were initially using only passive instruments.
Passive instruments.
When did you first started using active instruments?
Active instrument, we had the RSAT, RA radar imaging satellite, where I was somewhat connected, but not deeply connected. That radar instrument worked wonderfully well. We have done a lot of research related to vegetation,
mm,
Antarctic ice formation and how ice melts. Several things have come out very, very significant.
Now, let's explore this active instrument a little bit more so that,
yeah,
I mean, we understand.
Yeah.
Okay. So, on the ground, if I want to put a radar, for example, we all know that you use a radar to detect, let's say, enemy plane.
Yes.
Okay, I mean, or even any aircraft moving here and there.
Yeah.
Right? So you put a radar instrument on the border.
Yes.
You send the radar.
Yeah.
When it hits the
target,
mm-hmm, let's,
mm-hmm,
say,
mm-hmm,
it gets reflected and comes,
yes,
back.
Yeah.
So most of these planes has to be some kind of a metal, otherwise it won't,
yes,
reflect,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
This is what we know about radar.
Exactly.
When you say that I'm sending radar from space, is it that easy? For example, how much power you would need? Will it not, the when it comes from that high, let's say about 400 kilometers, 500 kilometers high, when you are sending a signal, it will spread. So at each point, the amount of, you know, the flux or strength of radar would be so low.
Yes.
How do you look at all this?
Precisely. Thing? This is where the trick in processing, synthetic aperture radar processing, to compare, to understand in a general terms, It is the more you look at the signal for a long time,
okay,
you integrate the small signals mm-hmm. and bring it to the level of detection.
Wait, this is a very, very interesting point. This is what we are going to explore further.
Yeah.
But for want of time, we are going to take a short break.
Okay.
Let it be a kind of, a suspense, how yes. the synthetic radar aperture works.
Yes. Yes.
Let's take a short break. Keep watching Eureka. After this break, we are going to continue this very, very wonderful conversation. Keep watching Eureka.
Which article defines qualification for the membership of Rajya Sabha? Article 84 of the Constitution lays down the qualifications for the membership of the Rajya Sabha.
Welcome back to Eureka. We are having a very wonderful guest today, Dr. G. Raju. He is a former project director of Isro. He has worked on very important remote sensing equipment, synthetic aperture radar, which can detect water even under the soil. So before the break, we left it at some kind of a suspense. I mean,
yes.
you said that you look at the same object for quite a long time, you know it better.
Yes.
So if I am passing through some doors,
yes.
and I hear some voice, it looks like Dr. G. Raju, but I'm not so sure. So I stand for a few seconds, I listen furthermore,
yeah.
then I become more confirmed that
yes.
it's you.
Yes.
Is it the kind of way I'm using?
Yes. You are talking about audio frequencies, I'm telling you, in electromagnetic waves.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's called synthetic. You're synthesizing the signal. Synthesizing means adding incoherence. So amplify the low signal, what you're telling, because we are 1,000 kilometers up. Just go and come back, the loss of signal
yeah.
is in the propagation,
yeah.
will reduce the reception of the data at that point when it comes to the... So whenever you have a target, suppose you have a water, you have got a metallic object or any kind of vegetation, natural as well as man-made objects, the two properties here, we have talked about the resolution and the intensity. The other one is, if I send a signal, a pulse, what is signal? Nothing but an electromagnetic pulse. It will have a shape. I know very well what is the shape of the pulse. I know what is the amplitude.
Sending
the signal of a known amplitude, known shape, I know my position of this transmitting signal. But the return signal will get distorted. What kind of distortion? It can get delayed. Obviously, it goes and comes back. That's the fundamental principle of a radar. So the return signal comes with a delay. So I know where exactly this has originated from, number one. Number two, I know the shape of the pulse. That means it has eaten away some of the amplitude. It has distorted the pulse. Everything has a very rich information. Shape of the pulse, delay. Suppose I'm sending a sharp pulse, but it comes distorted. Because there are not only one object. It is not a building. There are trees, there are roads. So it gets spread. But when it comes back, I know very well that this has come from this target based on the Doppler shift.
Okay.
Each one of the, suppose I got 4 points.
Oh.
Each of the A, B, C, D will have its own target. Return signal will have a Doppler shift.
Oh.
I filter out the Doppler. That is where I get the differentiation in location.
Very, very, very interesting. Now let's go forward. I mean, one of the project that you worked is in finding Antarctic ice.
Yes.
And there is also a huge interesting story of why yeah. people actually wanted to measure ice thickness using synthetic aperture radar.
Yeah.
So let's start with the story.
Yeah. See, why are we going for all the measurements with respect to snow, ice?
Uh-huh.
Because there is, you know, all of us are very concerned about global warming.
Uh-huh.
What is global warming do apart from the gases and other things? It melts the Antarctic ice and the polar and the Himalayan, all.
Yeah.
But the maximum ice is concentrated in the poles.
Yeah.
That means, imagine, hypothetically, after some time, because of global warming, with all kinds of activities on Earth, the whole Antarctica or Greenland, North and South Pole, ice melts. Then the sea level will rise by 60 meters.
Yeah, yeah.
That is a theoretical estimation. That means what happens? Whole of Bombay will be more or less submerged.
Yeah.
All coastal cities will be affected.
Mm.
So we have to control we have to control, and we should know whether the ice is growing or depleting. So this is called water and mass balance.
Okay.
This is a very important subject in climate change, and for that we need a suitable radar. So we have found out in some particular event in his from literature, we have found out that how did we find out the capability of radar for ice thickness? Mm. There is a story in 1959, there was a flight, there was an aircraft flying in the Greenland area.
Okay.
Flying at about several hundred meters. Uh-huh. It was flying over the thick ice. Mm-hmm. It was supposed it landed.
Okay.
It crash landed.
Ah.
Why? Because the radar return ice state, it depends upon the time.
Uh-huh.
So there are two pulses. One small pulse from the top and a strong pulse from the bottom.
Oh, okay, okay. So it penetrated the ice and then
penetrated to the ice. So the strong signal showed that I am still in the air, but it is not. I have already touched the ice.
Okay, okay. Now I get the point. So you have one small signal and a big big signal.
Exactly.
So now if you everywhere you measure this, you will know whether the ice is thick or thin.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
That's how you find.
Exactly.
So that's how you went into Antarctic ice expedition.
That is
right?
How we...
Which year you went there?
I went to Antarctica as a part of my PhD work. I took leave from Isro.
Uh-huh.
And I spent 4 years. I was more attracted by the fact that I might go to Antarctica.
Okay, okay.
One of the exciting experiences,
obviously,
very few people.
Yeah.
I had a very good experience of spending 2 seasons on the Antarctic ice.
Oh, really? That's great.
My PhD topic was to build a radar and show it works to measure kilometer thickness of ice.
That's very interesting. Now, let's slightly go forward. I mean, in ISRO, one of the major tasks that you took up was you were the project director for Mega Tropics project.
Yes.
It's an Indo-French project. What is this project's main name was?
Yeah, this is basically a climate-related project.
Okay.
Atmosphere and water cycle. Mm-hmm. Basically, it was meant for tropics.
Okay.
Why tropics? Because the maximum activity in the relative meteorology, meteorological particles, let us say particles in a sense, water, cloud, ice, particles, they are all concentrated in the belt,
no.
A tropical belt. So we are very much interested to know the dynamics,
okay.
Exchange of heat, and also the total atmosphere of the whole globe.
Okay.
What is important in this tropics thing, what is important in this mission is, if I want to make measurements, I should repeatedly measure very fast.
Okay.
Because dynamic. It's changing.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, exactly.
So I should know very quick sampling of in time, sampling of the data. So the tropical megatropic satellite was an inclined orbit, focusing only on the tropics, plus minus 23 degrees. Don't want to waste time going to North Pole or South Pole.
Okay, okay.
Focus only on the tropical belt.
So it was a special satellite that
yes.
was built by Indo-French collaboration.
Yes.
And did a climatic study.
Yeah.
That's a very interesting aspect. Now that you are retired, are you really retired?
Hey, mentally, I'm not yet retired. I'm still continuing keeping active myself. I'm a visiting professor. I'm a professor in Jain University.
Mm-hmm.
I have been trying to, when I was in ISRO, I had to meet deadlines.
Ah.
I cannot do too much of research.
Mm-hmm.
They will allow research, fine. But I have to meet deadlines in delivering the satellite.
Okay.
So I have some limitation in time. But when I retired and I looked for some places, I joined the university, and to support me, I continued my contact with ISRO. I have many projects, at least 6 projects from ISRO under various schemes. ISRO encourages all the academic institutions to do research.
Yeah.
I was lucky to have ready-made requests for under sponsored research called RESPOND project.
Mm-hmm.
There is, the latest is NAVIC.
Yeah.
Navigation using Indian constellation.
Yeah, yeah.
So we have some projects under NAVIC.
Uh-huh.
I have a new project under ISRO, NASA, that's called NISAR, NASA ISRO Synthetic Aperture Radar.
Okay. Which is again going to measure the ice.
Going to mostly for climate related, mostly vegetation cover, biomass.
Uh-huh.
One of the most wonderful, it will come in a few, 1 or 2 years. So we are preparing. We are preparing through some projects given to us by ISRO, and I'm busy with some students working on these topics.
Very, very, very interesting. I suppose this part also shows his excitement. you are retired, so it doesn't mean that you are stopping to think. You continue to think, you continue to work. And also look at some very interesting part. I mean, ISRO, we all think that it's a rocket going to space, maybe sending somebody on the space, they will all float. No, there is a lot of unseen effect on our life. Today, if we are able to predict the cyclone very well and save life, it's because of some seed that was sown 40 years ago. Today, if you have a great challenge of global warming and if you are going to tackle it, that's going to be the seed that we are now seeding through this kind of projects for monitoring the global warming and global pollution. Sir, thank you for being with us. It's a very short duration, so we need to end this conversation
it's
here.
It's my pleasure.
It's been a very, very wonderful conversation. We'll end this conversation here. Keep watching Eureka. We'll come back with another interesting episode next week, same time.